Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours.
I am yours. I am yours.
It's just me. Nobody loves me today.
Harry, you finally showed up.
Let the eyes that see my sin
look
on me
morning,
with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. Because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
Ephesians chapter 4. Back up into chapter 3, verse 16. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit. Where? In the inner man. Good morning, Conan. Grace and peace to you, brothers. Good to see you. In the inner man. See that semicolon? That means it continues on. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, and that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, and the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be the glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, the prisoner of the Lord beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation and where you were called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit of the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through you all, and in you all. But to every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now he that ascended is also what it is, but he also is descended first into the lower parts of the earth. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, and cunning of craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Good morning to you guys. Meg, love you. Al, what's up, brother? Good to see you guys. Children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. What else does Scripture say? Forever learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Right? Never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. If you want to know about Jesus Christ, you're going to have to go to the Apostle Paul. So this morning I woke up, and there was a gentleman who was saying that the entire New Testament was wrong, that he could prove that Paul's letters were a lie. So I said, well, what do we have here? I can prove Paul's letters are right. So the guy said, well, come on up here, Danny. Needless to say, Danny got kicked off the guy's life. God never heard about the body of Christ being kept secret from the creation of the world or why the body of Christ was kept secret from the creation of the world. He never heard Romans 16, 25 through 26, according to the commandment of the everlasting God for the obedience of faith among all nations. He didn't know, Paul said in Romans chapter 2, 16, in the day God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. I think he got pissed off when I told him he was born after Jesus Christ went and sat at the right hand of God 1,995 years ago. So what they like to do is go, oh man, Jesus Christ didn't fulfill the law. He didn't blot out the handwriting of ordinances that was contrary to us, taking it out of the way and nailing it to his cross, did he? They try to manipulate Paul's letters into saying the law is still in existence. So I said, hey man, you might want to go back and look at Galatians chapter 2. You know, Peter has the gospel of the circumcision. That's what you're preaching. Paul has the gospel of the uncircumcision. In Christ, circumcision nor uncircumcision availeth anything but a new creature. You got it? You don't got it, do you? You think you're a Hebrew in the body of Christ concerning this time of grace. No. You're dead. Your life is hid in Christ. It's now Christ that lives through you. He's not a Hebrew. He is the King. He is the image of the invisible God. So throughout the Old Testament, God didn't reveal who he was. Paul's letters, prophecy revealed. That's what the Old Testament is, a mirror of the New Testament. So what we're dealing with are people that don't know the Bible as well as they think they do. Because I'm going to tell you straight up, you attack one word in this Bible and you got nothing. You either take it as the word of man or you're taking it as the word of God. So you're taking it as the word of man and as the word of God. A little bit of both, right? We just can't seem to make a decision. Are we going to give the Bible the final authority so it can work effectively in our lives or not? There's the answer, or not. Forever learning, carried about with every wind of doctrine, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Why? False doctrine produces more false doctrine, doesn't it? What are you? Wise in your own conceits. Romans 11, 25. That's what you are. Lest any man be wise in his own conceits, let him acknowledge that Israel is in part blinded until the fullness of the Gentiles should come in. Who's wise in their own conceits? Torah followers. Who else? Those who are attacking the Apostle Paul. Who else? The Buddhists? The Muslims? All 55,000 denominations are attacking the truth. What is that truth? Jesus Christ is the truth, the life, and the way. They didn't get it. For somebody to sit back and say that the Apostle Paul wasn't under the inspiration of God when he wrote Romans to Philemon is flat out absurd. Absurd. This is coming from somebody, like I said, that haven't spent very much time in the Bible at all. So in Ephesians chapter 2, God is taking and making of himself twain, one new man today. He's taking Jew and Gentile and making a new creature out of those. You're not taking what's for the nation of Israel and applying it to the body of Christ. Why? Why not? 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, for the former things have passed away, that we henceforth know no man after the flesh. All 55,000 religions or denominations are judging by an outward appearance. We no longer judge by an outward appearance. You know why? Because we know what took place on the cross. They don't. That's why they're still judging by an outward appearance. The results of sin are death. Why are you aging? So you're dealing with a bunch of self-righteous hypocrites who think that they're above everybody else. When in reality, we're all bought and paid for with the bloodshed that took place at Calvary. There's no one righteous, no, not one. So without the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ, you can't go to heaven. What's going to happen? Israel inherits the earth. The body of Christ gets the third heaven past that North Star. So what happens if you're a Gentile born after Jesus Christ died on the cross and you keep trying to live by the law that was already fulfilled? You're going to burn up. Number one, if you don't believe Jesus Christ died for you, was buried and rose from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures, you're not coming with us at all. You're going to burn up in a flame and fire. So that's where Paul said, if any man come to you with a different doctrine than what he gave us, to let him be accursed. The guy that's saying Paul's letters aren't true is the one that's accursed. We'll stick with the Apostle Paul over what you say any single day. Your words aren't penned inside of this book. Your words haven't been preserved for over 400 years. The truth is, all scripture is inspired by God. Paul told, or Jesus Christ told Paul what to write. That's what the prophets were doing in times past, simply repeating what God said. How come these people who are claiming to be prophets and apostles today don't know what God said? I already gave you the answer. Romans 11:25. They're wise in their own conceits. Concerning the gospel, they are enemies. Why? Because they're preaching the gospel of the kingdom, not the gospel of Jesus Christ. But concerning the elect, who's that? That small remnant of Israel that did believe. Peter, James, John. That's the small remnant of Israel that did believe. What happened to them? They died. So that's why Paul said, even at this present time, there were members of the little flock that were still alive. How about today? Are we still provoking Israel to jealousy today? No. Why not? Because there is no Israel. You're either in Adam or you're in Christ. What happens? The body of Christ gets caught up in the clouds, taken out of the way, and then, and only then, does God write his laws in their hearts. What laws? Well, the guy asked me this morning, the same one that told me the New Testament was crap. Did I live by the Ten Commandments? You know what Danny said? You can fulfill all 616 laws by loving your neighbor as you love yourself. And you know what he said? That's a damn lie. I said, what'd you say? He said, that's a damn lie. I said, that's the word that came specifically from our Lord and Savior. This guy's calling Jesus a liar. No wonder we can't get on the same page. He's not even saved. In order to be saved, you're going to have to come to terms with what took place at Calvary. And you ain't going to do that by observing days and meats and bread and all that, living by the flesh. That's what that is. A perfection of the flesh. That's what the law is. That's where scripture told us. Bodily exercise profit little, but godliness is gain, right? Just knowing that you've got Christ inside of you, the hope of glory. See, those people in the Old Testament were dying for God's Holy Spirit to fall on them. You are sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. They were identified by who was the uppity up. You and I are identified by Jesus Christ, that they don't know. Who is the image of the invisible God is who he is. So they don't even comprehend who Jesus Christ is. So how many times have you guys ever heard me wake up and say, hey, I come out here this morning. Is today going to be the day that I ball everything up that I've learned it, throw it in trash and go start over? Evolution is destroyed with the very first verse of our Bible. In the beginning, God created. God didn't explode. God created. Evolution, you're saying it, perfection was created out of chaos, and that's not the case. God knew us before he said, let there be light. That means it was premeditated. Right? So what's happening? Danny came across somebody that's got his number. No. But I'm finding out that there are people out there that know the Bible as well as I do. And it's scary. Why? Because that same person that knows the Bible as well as I do doesn't rightly divide. And that's dangerous. It's very dangerous. If you don't know, the body of Christ was kept secret from the creation of the world because the rulers and the princes of this world would have never crucified the Lord of glory. You might start taking things that were back in Psalms and start applying them to us as members of the body of Christ. King David wrote the book of Psalms. Where's David? That's in Acts chapter 2. Where's David? Is David in heaven? Is Mary in heaven? Where's David? This is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. You just don't spend enough time in your Bible. What is it, Acts 2:16? No. It's Acts 2:34. For David is not ascended into heavens. Why not? David gets the earth. Matthew 5:5, the meek shall inherit the earth. So at judgment day, David gets put back into his body and he stands before the Lord. And the Lord says, welcome, my humble and faithful servant. Let all of the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made the same Jesus Christ, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ. That's a crazy, to me, that's just crazy. That just in the same chapter over here, if we continue to read, there was added to them about 3,000 souls that day. They believed Peter's message, but these clowns today won't. Why not? Because they're going about to establish their own righteousness, have never established or submitted themselves to the righteousness of Christ. You can't submit yourself to what you're not aware of, are you? The only thing you're aware of is that you can't eat a bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit. You got a checklist. What's the difference between following the Torah and being a Jehovah's Witness? None. You got a bunch of rules, you're in a cult. I've got absolute freedom. Steadfast ye in the liberty and not be entangled with the yoke of bondage. Oh, ye foolish Galatians. You guys keep trying to twist Paul's letters and Paul's telling us we need to live by the law. Maybe Paul's talking to Jews that were in Galatia, telling them the same thing he told them in Romans 2. Tanya. This is what's happening, guys. Every election, they replay everything in front of our faces again, right? Just like we're dealing with Roe versus Wade. Right, this has been going, what, abortion has been going on since when? Since before we was born, since before I was here. But somehow or another, it's still a major problem or persuading somebody's vote. The carrot hanging in front of the donkey. What are we magnifying? Gun violence. What else are we magnifying? We're going to magnify police brutality. What else are we going to magnify? Racism. Okay, let's magnify something else. Everything but something good. Everybody can identify the problems, but nobody can identify the answers to the problems. For example, you mean to tell me that two 80-year-old men are the best that this country has to offer? Somebody's gotten got. They want you more focused on what's going on here. That way you'll never come across the revelation of the mystery. You'll never come across God was in Christ, reconciling the world, no longer imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the message of reconciliation. That should get you out of your denomination. Why? God was in Christ, reconciling the world. That means he brought the world back under his subjection, no longer imputing their trespasses unto them. Your denomination is still imputing trespasses. Your denomination is no different than the slave owners that didn't free the slaves once they found out slavery was abolished. Just like you're not telling people the law ended when Jesus Christ fulfilled it. You're a bald-faced liar, and you're going to pay dearly for distorting the word of God. God's will for all men to be saved, for all men to come to the knowledge of the truth. You go back and live by the law, you've made it only about God's chosen royal priesthood, not the world. So for you to automatically assume that you're part of God's chosen royal priesthood 2,000 years after they were blinded, you just make it up as you go. You're not over here in Ephesians 4 with us. One Lord, one faith. You're forever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of truth. Why? Because you don't know the love of Christ surpasses all knowledge. I want to say welcome to you guys this morning. We're going to be in 1 Timothy chapter 1 this morning. If you got your Bibles, flip on over there. I'm not going to continue to beat a dead dog. 1 Timothy chapter 1, guys. Let's continue to press on. There's only one thing to do. You've got to somehow put your money where your mouth is, right? Make full proof of your ministry. Prove what you're saying. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul said, marvel not, for Satan himself can transform into an angel of light. It's no great thing that he has ministers that transform into angels of righteousness too. I'm going over there. What's the law about? Works. Oh. So you want to cut them? Here's how you cut them. You cut them deep. Don't play with them. Just like the dude you told me I do security. If you're going to grab somebody, you grab them. Don't go grabbing somebody half-assed. They're going to turn around and knock your teeth out. You're going to get elbowed. Something's going to happen. So when you grab them, you grab them. You make sure they know they were being grabbed. Just like Satan. What's he doing? Deceiving people. Who? The simple. He's not going to come over here and attack me with a full set of armor of God on, is he? No. He's going around looking for that guy that don't know what's inside of his Bible. Why? So that he can keep him in bondage. And what are we doing? Convincing the gainsayers. That's who oppose themselves. We're not fighting against you. We're fighting for you. Because if you need to live by the law, then you're saying that I need to live by the law. And I'm saying how that who we are dead to sin live any longer there in it. The law was the acknowledgement of sin. Where there's no law, there's no transgression. You've made up an imaginary law that you're living by today. It's just not there. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers. That's who the Torah followers are. Deceitful workers. Transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. He gave apostles for what? For the building of the body of Christ. In order to be an apostle, you must have been what? With Jesus from the baptism of John until when? Until Jesus Christ went and sat at the right hand of God in Acts 1. Or you're not an apostle. What? Anybody else not hear me? Do some sign language. Yeah, Brother James, you may just have to leave and come back. Sometimes it happens. Mine was doing that yesterday over there on Preacher John's page. Did y'all get to hear Preacher John yesterday? Isn't that God bless him? What an absolute wonderful brother in Christ he is to have, guys. If you don't know Brother John, guys, reach out to Brother John. The reason that I invited him to come to the platform was because of who he was. I knew that you guys needed him. I knew that I'd come in here and tear you up pretty bad, and Preacher John would come and wrap his arms around you and tell you how much he loves you, you know, and that's where we come together, all of us, as members of the body of Christ. I think we make a fantastic team, and I think we have a wonderful family here together, guys. Preacher John's been around for a little while now. I can't begin to tell you how much it brought joy to me to see Preacher John become a grandpa. And we're just thankful for Preacher John and his ministry. Same thing with my brother Aaron. You know, sometimes life has us so busy that we're doing other things. You know, Aaron's getting ready to retire, I think about 2 years. And he's got a lot going on that I really can't discuss with you guys. Just know that everybody's doing the best that they can. And sometimes, guys, that's where you say, hey, just keep on doing what you're doing. I know that guy is giving you a hard time. I know he's a handful. And that's what's going to happen to Dan. I'm going to probably reach out and bite something I shouldn't be biting. But that's why I'm here. So I'll just tell you the answers. There's this guy who's absolutely brilliant. I've never heard anybody explain the Word of God or share the Word of God the way that this guy does. I've been seeing a lot of our mid-acts brothers and sisters listening to this guy. So I started listening to him. And it dawned on me, he's not approved by God. So without being approved by God, we don't care how much scripture you know, do we? We think it's great that you know scripture, but if you're not taking into context who, what, where, when, why, And you're doing the same thing that the Torah followers are doing. You're just making it up as you go. There is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. The reason that that is important is because Paul says circumcision or uncircumcision availeth anything but a new creature. If it's by grace, then it can't be by works. Preacher John, Ruth and Wayne, he'll be here in a few minutes probably. Preacher John, if it's by works, it's no more grace. If it's by grace, it's no more works. So they're going to try to add works to you during this time of grace. Like what? Like living by the law. Satan's minion might try to talk you into chopping down trees. If you really love God, you'll build a boat. You, hopefully, would have the biblical knowledge to tell these people that God made a rainbow, that he wouldn't flood the earth again. So 1 Timothy chapter 1. Yesterday, I think we left off in verse 15. You guys got your Bibles? 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. We'll back up to verse 12 this time. Okay? We're going to back up to verse 12. We'll read it. When we get to verse 15, we'll stop. And we'll unpack it and continue to press on down through 1 Timothy chapter 1. Only 20 verses in here. We should have no problem knocking out these five verses and maybe jumping into chapter 2 this morning. And chapter 2 is only 15 verses. So that's where you start seeing, like for example, back in Luke, some of them chapters have 60 verses in it. So as you can see with Timothy running into 2 Timothy, Titus, and Philemon, Paul's getting to the end of his ministry is what he's doing. Not only were they reading the letters that Paul wrote in Rome, they were taking those letters in Rome and copying them and then sending them back out throughout the churches too. So that's where sometimes Paul says, hey, you've already known because I already told you about this. So 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me. For that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who before was a blasphemer and a persecutor, injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, who I am chief. Does anybody know why Paul was chief? Let's see what I got. All right, let's do Romans chapter 5. Verses 8 through 10. Romans chapter 5, 8 through 10. Good morning, Matthew. WAG. Outstanding. Ryan. Come over here trying to ruin our ministry, brother. What's wrong with you, man? No. Romans 5. That's outstanding, WAG. Warrior. I'm not sure what that means, okay? I like to use it as a dog wagging his tail. I like that dog wag. I like that. Hazy Daisy, you got it, sister. That's the answer. I'm glad to see you guys know the answers. AT, what's up, brother? We were just talking about you. We were talking about how fantastic of brothers you and John Atberry are. And that's where I was telling them all. Well, I'm going to tell them right now. They got you on one side of the hurricane and John Atberry on the other side of the hurricane. The hurricane's coming up to the middle. That's why I was telling Meg, you might want to start watching out for the hurricane. She said, you mean God's got a timeline? What do you mean God's got a timeline? Yeah, it's a hurricane coming out there. It's coming up the coast. You think I should watch it? I think you probably ought to watch that over the Chosen. If you need to come to Virginia, now might be the time. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. You want to come to Virginia? Come on down. Come on up, right? Romans chapter 5, 8 through 10. But God commanded his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's what's so special about God. Even when we didn't love him, he loved us. Verse 9, much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Verse 10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Did you get that? When we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. That's even before you believed. Enemies was when the Gentiles were alienated from Christ, having no hope and without God in the world. All right, let's go back to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. This is a faithful saying worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came to the world to save sinners, who I am chief. 1 Timothy chapter 4. Let's go look at verse 9. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. These things command and teach. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. What else did Paul say? Philippians 1:27. He didn't say only let your conversation be the Torah, did it? No, only let your conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. Why? Because when the last person comes to terms with what took place at Calvary, that's going to end this time of grace, and the body of Christ is going to get caught up in the clouds. That's why. Are the Torah followers bringing people to Christ? No, they're bringing people to the law. So you mean to tell me that Israel has been blinded or cut off, and these people are being born, and they're living by the law that was fulfilled? Yes. Yep. What does that mean? Well, number one, they don't know Jesus Christ. Number two, they don't know the gospel, so they're not saved. Number three, they don't give Paul the authority that Jesus Christ gave him in Acts 9, which means they're not even spiritual. So you got somebody that's constantly trying to tell you about God's word that's not even saved. That's why there's 55,000 denominations. None of them can understand God's word. Why? None of them are saved. What? Have you ever seen 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 on any church sign? If you do, stop and take a picture of it. If you do, go up and knock on the door and shake that guy's hand. That's why Paul says, howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Christ Jesus might show forth a long suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to everlasting life. Our pattern is not Moses. Moses was never speaking to the Gentiles. God's law for God's chosen royal priesthood, more specifically the tribe of Levi. So verse 15, that was 1 Timothy 4, 9. I got 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 11. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. You hear that? In the kitchen, barefoot, pregnant, that's where you belong. Somebody out there said, yeah, finally somebody said it. Be quiet, woman. Let the woman learn in silence. At that time, guys, they still went to a building, so to speak. Here you go. I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, and I went to Macedonia, that thou might charge some that they teach no other doctrine. I'm just joking, sister. You guys should know we're all one in Christ. We're all one. But what does the body of Christ do? It edifies itself together in love. Now, you have to remember, they were still, I say, pinging off of the temple. Pinging off of the temple meaning mimicking things that were going on in the temple, like, you remember? depending on what tribe you were in, depending on what gate you went in. So women sat on in a certain area, Gentiles sat in another area. They all sat in their own area. So when they went into the temple, the women sat together and the men sat together. And that's why they asked the women to be quiet, so there wouldn't be a bunch of confusion going back and forth. So that's where we say, well, why didn't Paul tell Timothy that he was the church? That Christ don't dwell in man-made buildings. How long would it have been before somebody in Cretia would have gotten that letter written to Rome? Do you think it ever happened? Remember, Phoebe was told to take that gospel to Rome, that they should assist our sister in whatever she needs help with. What does she need help with? Get these people off of me. Food, shelter, water, clothing. I'm lost. Help me, am I on the right track? You know, we've been expecting you. We've been looking for you for 3 years right here on this platform. That's good to know, Matthew. I'm glad, I appreciate you sharing that with us that already know that stuff. That's good. I remember my first beer. I thought I was cool. Now I said, man, this tastes like piss. My favorite is sweet tea. You put some sweet tea together, Danny's gonna be happy. Sweet tea. So man's always trying to try to assort his authority over a woman. And we don't assort our authority over each other. We assort the authority in the doctrine. The doctrine, that's where it's at. So you're not arguing with a woman, you're arguing with the doctrine is what you're doing. And you're not arguing with the doctrine, you're arguing with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is what you're doing. So that's my recommendation to the sisters, is this. If somebody comes up and they start trying to suppress you and talk about you don't got no business talking about God, I wouldn't even respond to them. I'd straight up block them. Right then and there. Block. Especially when you're preaching the gospel, the truth, our salvation, so that we can go home. And somebody's going to try to discourage you, just like this lady right here talking about Melina and Donald. Yep. Well, we're going to help you right on with them. I don't know why. Yeah. What's up, Mario? It's good to see you here. Hopefully you've still been hanging out and listening. See, this is the problem with religion as well. They're not willing to put their time in. One thing that I noticed that we're doing that they don't do, it's called turning the page. This is what we're doing. We're inside the Bible, finding out exactly what the Bible says. The context, the settings, everything that's going on in that specific part of the Bible. Where religion is taking everything that's in this Bible, warping it and twisting it, and trying to apply it to you and your life. You can never be a David. You're not a king. You're not around Nephilim. You never saw a 10-foot giant. We don't throw rocks. Desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor what they affirm. Right? You know, the law is for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, men stealers. It's a better word. But I think we'd probably be in trouble if we used that word. It begins with an F and ends with a T. Got two G's in the middle of it. That's what my boy Roundhouse's mom would call him. We laughed and laughed and laughed at him so bad that day. He's like, oh man. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, guys. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13. Two verses up. Who before was a blasphemer, persecutor, injurious, but I obtained mercy. Because he did it ignorantly in unbelief. Is God still winking at ignorance? The times of this ignorance God once winked at, but now he's commanded all men everywhere to repent. And what else? Have faith in Jesus Christ. What? Come out of that law. You better have faith in Jesus Christ. And I got Philippians. What do I got? He don't got nothing. He don't got nothing. Don't know where Philippians came from. I liked it when I saw it, though. I was like, ooh, that's nice. Titus 3:8. We move along. Titus chapter 3, verse 8. Likewise, the deacons must be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre, holding the mystery of faith with a pure conscience. I can't find one deacon that's preaching according to Romans 16, 25 through 26. And the reason is because there are no more elders of the churches. Today, we're all one in Christ. We are all bought and paid for. Nobody's in front of or behind. Now, what we do have are weaker brothers and stronger brothers. That doesn't mean that you're not any less paid for or you're any less important in God's eyes. Verse 16, howbeit I obtain mercy, that in me first Christ Jesus might show forth long-suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter on believe to him everlasting life. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12. That at that time, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Here's the pattern. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you stand. Which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory of what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Paul was chosen to be the pattern by Jesus Christ. So that's where Jesus Christ knew that many would come saying that they were the Christ. So that's why Jesus Christ gave it to Paul. Let's do 2 Thessalonians. I'll tell you what, just 2 Thessalonians. Chapter 1. 1 through 10. Just write that down. 2 Timothy 2:11. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abide faithful, he cannot deny himself. So go back to 1 Timothy 1. Everybody all right? Y'all having breakfast out there? Fruit Loops? Got it from Fruit Loops. Still staying 16 here, okay? Ooh, that's probably where Philippians... Nope. Also, I have, for verse 16, I got Romans 5, 20 through 21. That's the same verse we read up there previously. So just write that down. This time for verse 16, I got Romans 2, 4 through 5. Romans chapter 2. Here comes the sweat. Romans chapter 2, 4 through 5. I think if you can get past the initial I'm sweating thing, you'll be all right. The problem is we don't want to sweat. You're going through that, oh no, I can't start sweating. But you will. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. But after thy hardness and impotent heart, treasures up thyself wrath against the day of wrath, and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. To them who by patient continuance and well-doing seek for glory, honor, immortality, eternal life. But to them which are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath. Who's going to have indignation and wrath? Torah followers. Why? They're not under grace. They are under grace, but it doesn't mean anything. For not hearers of the law are just before God, but doers of the law shall be justified. You see that, Danny? For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these having not the law, are a law unto themselves, which show the work of the law, written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts the meanwhile accusing, or else excusing one another. That's what they're doing. Accusing or excusing. Oh, don't worry about it. We just won't tell anybody about that. God knows. What about your thoughts? Who's going to fix those? Who's going to fix your thoughts? You might be able to fool everybody out here into thinking you're a good guy. But what about the inside? Remember what Jesus said? On the outside, you're like whitewashed tombs. But on the inside, what are you? Rotten. Rotten. What's this mean? Somebody might be alive on the outside, but dead on the inside. How do we get life in there? Huh? I've been telling you the whole time, and you won't listen. Why not? Because you can't read. Why don't you just admit the truth? You can't read. Just like somebody might say, I can't swim, Danny. I just didn't want to tell you because I was embarrassed about it, and I knew that it probably never come to pass, and I had to put it to the test. But now here we are. You're going to throw me in the water. Don't throw me in the water because I can't swim. At least you're being honest. You can't read? Okay. Well, faith comes from hearing and believing the word of God. I can read. I got you. Can't read very good. But I can read good enough. Paul came into the world to save sinners who he was chief. Paul did it because he was persecuting the church of God. That's that 2 Thessalonians 1:10 in the flame and fire. Taking vengeance on those that know not God and obey not the gospel. 2 Thessalonians 1. My Bible's about to fall apart, guys. When he shall come to be glorified in his saints, to be admired in all of them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day. What am I going to do? This thing's going to fall apart. It's coming out. Remember my last one did that. It just came right out. What's the middle of my Bible being? 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Dead flat in the middle. I think I need to write back over there to that Bible store and tell them, look, man. Y'all ready? Psalms 25:11. I've got Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. 55:7. And also 43:25. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13. We looked at that. Let's go down to verse 17, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. Now unto the King, that's a capital King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Okay? Let's write this one down while we're writing. Psalm 65:6. Lord of mercy. This is out of control. Psalm 47:6-8. Psalm 45:6. Psalm 57:11. Let's do 1 Timothy 6:15-16. 1 Timothy 6:15-16. Which in his times he shall show who is the blessed and only Pontiac, King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwell in the light, which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen, nor can see, to whom be the honor and power everlasting. Amen. You can check out Psalm 104, verse 2 for that. Back to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. I've got Ephesians chapter 3, 20-21. Ephesians 3. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be the glory of the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. You see that? Look at that. Isn't that nice? That was great, wasn't it? So if you don't know what you're talking about, what you just read, you can just say, isn't that nice? Isn't that nice, guys? Boy, what was that? Ephesians 3, 20 through 21. What do you mean he's able to do above all that we... that it do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think? You mean like make us members of his body? Set us in heavenly places with Christ? Never to be separated again? Abundantly above all that we ask or think would be outside of this mind? This mind is only capable of doing so much right now. Let's do Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. For he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Right? What are they doing? Attacking the deity of Jesus Christ. Why? They don't understand. Why don't they understand? Well, number one, without right division, you're not going to know who Jesus Christ is either. What do you mean? Some people might know who Jesus Christ is. Verse 16, for by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether there be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were created by him and for him. So, Trinity is not in the Bible. It's the concept of Trinity in the Bible. Three that bear record. Is that Father, Son, Holy Spirit? Then they're going to tell you, well, because the word Trinity is not found in the Bible, and that comes from the Catholic doctrine. Does that mean that every single thing that came from the Catholic Church is a lie? Well, you want the answer? Yes. Every single thing that came from the Catholic Church is a lie. Why? Well, where do they get their instructions from? From somebody that's representing Judah? From somebody that's claiming to be a Jew, but you're really a Gentile? Yes. Is Pope established by Paul's doctrine? No. Trinity found inside of this Bible? No. Is Jesus Christ ever referred to as God the Son? No. They're saying Jesus isn't the Father. So when you show them a verse like John 15, 7 says, from henceforth now you have known and seen the Father. That doesn't mean anything to them. Why? They're Bible correctors. Just like Paul's letters aren't inspired. Well, if they weren't inspired, they wouldn't be in between these two covers. In between the two covers is time. Time. So, the beast, the dragon, and the false prophet make up the Trinity. There's one Lord, one faith, one walk, Jesus Christ. He is everything. So, that's all I have for verse 7. Well, no, it's not all I have. For verse 17, write this down real quick. Daniel chapter 7, verse 14. Daniel chapter 4, verse 37. That's why Paul said, if an angel comes to you, would the Pope be considered in that group? Yes. What's the Pope saying? We can bend God's laws to accommodate man's laws. See, that's where the Pope has taught the Vatican or their people to value what the Pope says over the Word of God. And that's how they deem to have unity, because we just go through the Pope. Whatever the Pope says, he's the only one that can understand what God's Word says. So we'll ask him. No, it's written on the fifth grade reading level. God wants all men to come to that knowledge. The knowledge. That's what Satan's trying to keep from you. Knowledge. So you have to go through the Pope? Verse 18, 1 Timothy chapter 1, guys. Frosty, what's up, brothers? Good to see you. This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest a war, a good warfare. Let's see if we can find it. It said, from a child thou hast known the scriptures, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy 3:15. And from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. You see, back at that time, Timothy didn't have a Bible. They had the scrolls. There were people reading the scrolls. Like I said, they were writing letters and sending them around. It's very possible that Timothy had some of copies. Maybe Timothy made his own copies of them. You know, it's like we had a brother in Christ that hand drew. He straight up hand drew the dispensational chart. Got my attention. And what that is a perfect example of how much zeal you can have without the knowledge. Going through the motions. Some of these people can draw very well. Draw this big forehead. Right. Sound doctrine, Meg. Sound doctrine. So if you go around somebody, right, and you believe Jesus Christ is the image of God, and they're teaching that Jesus Christ isn't God, why would you sit there and listen to them for? These things are designed to keep you from getting caught up in that nonsense. You can't get who Jesus Christ is right. You can't get nothing else right either. And that's where some people come, some people go. Here's another knucklehead, Raymond. Good morning to you. I'm gonna call you today, brother. All right? You don't have to answer, but I'm gonna call you till you do answer. That's what I'm gonna just, come on, as soon as you answer, I'm gonna hang up and call back. So that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all what? Good works. Good works. So like we say, you're preaching life, you're preaching bondage. Are you preaching good works? Then you're preaching spiritual works or what they are. Not fleshly, carnal-minded works, right? Well, Matthew, what Satan's going to do is come in and try to jerk out that these I like to call firewalls. You know what I mean? Somebody tells you, hey, I got a date when Jesus Christ is coming back. What? Get away from that guy, right? What? Just like Paul said, if an angel comes to you with a different doctrine than what I've given you, to let them be accursed. You're talking to the Buddhists, the Muhammad, Muslims. Not Muhammad. I was going to say Hindu. All over the earth, people know God is there. What we're doing is teaching them how to properly serve God. Good morning to you, Tori. Hope you and Ralph are doing well out there in Texas. I'm sure you guys might be getting, well, I guess y'all are probably safe from this hurricane. Tony, it's good to see you, sister. Tony Benjamin. Ooh, that's a cool name. Yeah, it's like John Jacob Jingleheimer Smith. His name is my name, too. Whenever we go out, the people always shout, there goes John Jacob Jingleheimer Smith. Da, 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 da. You don't know that song. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning to you. I give thee all the blessing. Come in. Come in. Verse 18, charge and commit unto thee, son Timothy. He's charging Timothy. You do it. You remember what he said? You give me my 21 steps because you report to this line. Report to this line. Right? I was like, oh, you better get up and give him his 21 steps, right? 1 Timothy 4:14. We might have read that one. We'll read it again. Neglect not the gift that is in thee. Ooh, grace is a gift from God, isn't it? So no man can boast, which was given to thee by prophecy with the laying on the hands of the presbytery. I need to do some research on the presbytery. All right, I got Philippians 2:22. Yep, Philippians 2:22. 877 cash now. But ye know the proof of him that as a son with the Father, he served with me in the gospel. Just like Onesimus. He was unprofitable when he ran away from Philemon. He got locked up, ran into Paul, and came back and was profitable. So hopefully if you leave because you're not profitable, hopefully when you come back, you'll be profitable. Right? Profitable. What we're talking about is this mystery of godliness, guys. Christ being formed inside of the believer who is faithful and just to finish the work. My man got 2 Timothy chapter 10. Are you serious? There's not 10 chapters there. Oh. Well, also that comes from wisdom too. Wisdom is just not being aware of what you do know. It's also being aware of what you don't know. Let's do, I wrote that one down twice. So we already knocked off 1 Timothy 6:20. Ephesians 6, 12 through 18. That's just the armor of God. You can write that down. Philemon 1:10. I don't know what Philemon 1:10 says. I beseech thee for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my bonds. So just like Paul is calling Timothy his son, he's calling Onesimus his son too. Was Onesimus a member of the little flock? No. My son in the faith. What faith? The faith of Christ. That's where we get sidetracked. Sidetracked. Why? Because you don't have those walls of protection, like a computer. What do you mean a wall? You start going outside of the button down dispensation, you need to climb a ladder and get out of that wall. What'd you do? Climbed over the cross. Why? Because it don't mean anything to you. You don't bypass the cross. What's the other side of it? James 1 or Hebrews. So that was Philemon 1:10, Titus 1:4. It's back one chapter to Titus. Titus chapter 1, verse 4. I better get on my horse. To Titus, my own son, after the common faith. So Titus was also. Remember what Paul said? If you had 10,000 instructors in Christ to be ye followers of me, for I have begotten you through the gospel. Many fathers. Jesus isn't the father. Did you know that? It's like, man, they say Jesus is the father. It's like, will you please stop taking away from our Lord and Savior? Can somehow just stop? Isaiah 9:6. His name shall be Everlasting Father. And that's not what it means. It just means he's the father of Israel. Nope. He is before all things, and by him all things consist. You're trying to turn Jesus Christ into a created being. They're arguing over him because they just can't comprehend it without God's Holy Spirit. That's what else I see on the platform. Somebody arguing with somebody that's not saved. You are looking for predestined members of the body of Christ who are going to come home with us. So if you're being rejected, let them go. Let's go down to verse 19, 1 Timothy 1. Holding faith and a good conscience, which some have put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. 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 It crashed. All right, I've got Acts chapter 19, verse 33. First Timothy chapter 5, verse 9, right? No. Yes. Maybe. It might be 1 Timothy 3, 9. Yeah. Yeah. Holding the mystery of faith in a pure conscience, and let these also be proved, then let them use the office of a deacon, being found blameless. Blameless, 2 Corinthians 6:3, the ministry must be blameless. So holding faith and a good conscience, faith, the faith of Christ justifies us, the good conscience, which some have put away, concerning faith have made shipwreck. All right. I've got, yep. Lot of them I'm writing it all down twice for. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 6. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 6. For this know also, in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents. If you don't know, these are people caught up in the flesh. Okay? Without natural affliction, truce breakers, false accusers, incontent. They don't have Christ. Incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Remember what sin abounds, grace abounds much more. We have a big God and a little sin. That's why we're happy. They have a little God and a big sin. And that's why they're miserable. They're miserable, and when they come around a group of people, they put on a show. And they pretend to be somebody that they're not. When in reality, they're the most bitter people you've ever met in your entire life. Why? Because they're sin conscious. Their God is conditional, so their love for you is going to be conditional. And that, my friends, is why none of them will go the extra mile with you and help you get your knowledge up. This is why your whole entire life you've been out here in this great country we call the United States, and none of these bastards will have the balls to walk up and tell you about our Lord and Savior. Spineless. You mean you don't witness to nobody? No, I got a better chance of being approached by a Jehovah's Witness. That's pathetic. Why? Because you're not prepared. You're not equipped. You are. You just don't know it. Why not? You won't read your Bible. What are you doing? Listening to man. Go down to 5, 2 Timothy 3. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For this sort they that which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts. That's Karen. She's standing there staring out the blinds because her husband died 3 years ago and she just can't seem to get over it. It's not never going to dawn on Karen that she's next. That maybe she should get her affairs in order. She's so concerned with everything that's going on outside that she's not worried about what's going on the inside. That's what I said. They even got Fox News playing in the inside of their car. You can't get enough of Fox News all day. You got to take it with you. There's only one thing that should be running around with you. And that's the Word of God. What did God say? Not what did Fox News say. All of these people had the same thing in common. They're not looking for our blessed hope. They think that what happens on Fox News or CNN is either going to make or break their day. Let's do 2 Corinthians 10, verse 6. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 6. And having a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Yep. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Chad. You're wrong. Okay. Let's prove it. Holding faith and a good conscience. A good conscience meaning you can prove your ministry with Scripture, not you just make it up and you get assurance from just making it up as you go. Right? He said he was born of God. Really?
born of God, man. You know where that's at? That's those that don't sin. He don't sin now that he's in Christ or that he's born again. He don't sin anymore, right? Chad, you've been freed from all sin. 1 John. Well, how come they got to confess those sins in order to be saved? How come they got to endure to the end if you're free? How come you got to endure to the end if you're free? I'm already bought and paid for with the bloodshed that took place at Calvary. Israel don't get saved until Judgment Day, Acts 3:19. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Well, that ain't you. What do I mean? You don't got God's laws written in your hearts. Do you? You got to tell your neighbor about God? You do? What sins do I confess that Jesus freed me? Okay. After the body of Christ removed, they got God's laws written in their heart. Jeremiah 31:31-34. That's not Chad. That's the house of Israel and the tribe of Judah is who that is. If they sin willingly after they come to the knowledge of the truth, then there's no more remission of sins because the animals were clean back at Calvary. So what are they going to have to do? Confess those sins. He who endures to the end can then what? Be saved. That's not you. You're bought and paid for with the bloodshed that took place at Calvary. So, holding faith and a good conscience, which some have put away, concerning the faith, have made shipwreck. There you are, Chad, shipwreck. What does that mean? You won't be able to grow in the knowledge of the Lord anymore. 2 Timothy 4:4. I'm going to keep coming back here with us, Chad. I just give you a hard time. Got your attention. I'm Danny. It's nice to meet you. And they shall turn their ears away from the truth and shall be turned into fables, like Chad. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, and make full proof of thy ministry. Full proof of the ministry. How do you do that? Go over to your favorite pastor and ask them to make, are you right or not? I think sometimes going around other believers in Christ would help us. Hey guys, what do you think about this? You got anything to add or take away from what I have to say here? 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. You got God's laws written in your hearts? You've been left. 1 Thessalonians 1:10, and to wait for his son from heaven, even Jesus, who has delivered us from the wrath to come. Mixing law and grace together means what? You're not approved by God. And why? Because that's going to affect your identity. Who are you? You're dead, and your life is hid in Christ. That's why you don't sin anymore. You're not in 1 John. You're in Christ is who you are. What? Yeah, Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4. If you be risen with Christ, you should be seeking those things above. Israel's looking for the Antichrist, the abomination of desolation. Makes sense? No, it will. Don't worry. If anything that I talk about doesn't make sense or you want more clarity on it, guys, don't be afraid to ask. I want you to write this one down. No. No, not yet. I should have read it. Go back. 1 Timothy chapter 6, 21. 6:21, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen. Erred. They were talking about the resurrection that had already passed. Just like we're dealing with today. Remember that guy Odell was well, y'all probably weren't here, some of y'all, but your flyaway doctrine. With outright division, you're going to take things that are for the nation of Israel and apply them to the body of Christ. So the very first place they go to find the calling up of the body of Christ is outside of our doctrine. Oh, that's moronic, isn't it? So you mean to tell me to consider what Paul says? You go over there and ask what Peter says? That's not considering what Paul says. That's considering what Peter says. If you want to consider what Paul says, you need the 13 epistles Paul wrote. Just like if you want to know what Peter said, try reading the epistles Peter wrote. maybe they have a different audience. I'm just saying. Maybe they're writing to different people. Maybe we're such lazy Bible students that we don't ever take into context or consideration who the audience is. Damn sure didn't take into consideration when you quoted 2 Chronicles 7:14, did you? If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves, then I would hear them from above. Who is the audience? Is it the nation of Israel or the body of Christ? Can it be both? No. If it's not about the body of Christ, then there's a 99.99% probability chance that it's about the nation of Israel. When you start applying you you've taken yourself from God's protection. You have now liberated yourself from the rest of us as members of the body of Christ. That's what liberation means, no longer protected by God. What? If God be for us, then who can be against us? Satan. So what we have to do, guys, is we have to stay armored up. All right? Constantly armored up. I don't know if y'all got all this or not, so I'm just going to recap verse 19, all right? We'll go through verse 19, write all this stuff down. Titus 1:9. Yep, there it is. I got 2 Timothy 4:4. 2 Timothy 4:14-15. I think that's what you're missing. 2 Thessalonians 3:15. Remember Acts 19:33. 1 Timothy 6:21. I've got 1 Corinthians 11:32. You thought the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit was the one called the Trinity. Yeah, I did too. It's all right, brother. They got us all. They got us all. I didn't either, Jeffrey. And that's where we start going. Once you start being exposed to what Satan's doing, you're going to start to see it. Once you start to see it, you'll never unsee what this bum has done. He's good. He's good. And what's he doing? He's banking on you, relying on somebody else to bring you peace, comfort, assurance, power, and a sound mind. As a member of the body of Christ, you are an able minister of the New Testament. You should be studying to show yourself approved by God. While you got me here giving you an underdog, you bring all the questions that you got. Get them on the table. Get the answers. Tomorrow's not promised. I might not be here. Then what? Do the same thing I did with Granddaddy. Think about these questions you have. You write them down. You bring them over here. You present them and we'll answer them together. If I don't know the answer, Tammy knows the answer. Conan might know the answer. Aaron knows the answer. John knows the answer. We got a lot of brothers and sisters in Christ. Justin, Don are growing in the knowledge of the Lord. They are firecrackers for God. I didn't mean to leave Kat out. She's a powerhouse. I can't be any more proud than I am of these brothers and sisters in Christ who are continuing to grow. Continuing to grow. So that's all I got for verse 19. Let's go verse 20. Last verse of the chapter. Of whom Hymenaeus. Knee to their kidneys, right? Hymenaeus. I don't know why somebody would name their kid that, but they did. And Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan. It's like Satan, he went and dropped them off. Paul knew where Satan lived. He said, I delivered them. I've been delivered. Remember, he said, I don't like men's no more. I like women's. I've been delivered. Delivered from what? Delivered from Papa John's? Delivered from resentment, anxiety, anger, frustration. Maybe you've been delivered from the law. Oh, you finally just now finding out about it. See what them dudes did? They didn't tell you about it, did they? Nope. Why wouldn't they tell you? Because they're wicked men. That's why. Let me tell you something. If I were president, you heard Wyclef say that. If I were president and I abolished slavery and I got wind that I have slave owners out here in my country that didn't free their slaves, those slave owners would have been in jail. Just like today. Nobody's in jail for it. Dead people voting. Nobody's in jail for voter fraud. Nobody cares about voter fraud. Not even an issue. It's cool. We'll just mail in votes and steal the election again. Because you know why? We're stupid enough to think we have an opinion. Just like your Democratic nominee that you didn't vote for. What's that called? A dictator. She's not qualified to run a Texaco. Is it a Texaco? Do y'all got Texacos? What do y'all got? Shells? It's a Shell station. The Sheets. We got a Sheets. He delivered them unto Satan. I think Hymenaeus and Alexander turned Paul in. Why? Alexander didn't want to give up the coppersmith. That's who he was, Alexander the coppersmith. Sometimes you ever seen some people do copper work? Some of it's very, 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 very beautiful. It takes a lot of critiquing and things to do it. And if you mess one thing up, you can mess the whole entire piece up. I've gotten that information just from using a break, wrapping metal, facial, soffit, doing things like that. You got to be careful because you can put little dinks and things all in over in the wood, in the metal. Hymenaeus and Alexander, who I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Basically, all Paul did was turn his back on him. Psalm 67, 1 through 4. I've got Acts chapter 17, verse 30. I've got Acts 19, 33. Okay? So let's go 1 Corinthians 11, 32. 1 Corinthians 11, 32. This is the first letter of correction to the Corinthians. Verse 32, Paul is telling them, but when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. No. Remember what Paul said? I reckon Romans 8, 1. There is now therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh. Remember, the results of the flesh are death, but the results of the Spirit are eternal life through Jesus Christ. The outward man is perishing. He's been bought and paid for with the bloodshed that took place at Calvary. Religion can't grasp it. It just can't get it. The outward man bought and paid for. The inward man, he's the one that's going to get judged at the judgment seat. Okay? That's what Satan's done. He's hidden almost 2,000 years of grace. And that's why today I'm dealing with some young kid telling me that I should live by the law that I was never under. Gentiles were alienated from Christ in times past. They had no hope. So for you to take something like people today and tell them that they should live by the law means you never read Acts 15. Should the Gentiles live by the law of Moses? No. Why not? Well, you don't take new wine and put it into old wine sacks, do you? Just like Jesus Christ said, even the dogs eat from the scraps that get dropped from the table. You don't take what's for the children and give it to the dogs. The dogs were the dispensation of grace. Very good, Chad. Outstanding, brother. Very good. Very good. Very good. I'm glad to see that. Back over to 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20, okay? Hymenaeus and Alexander, of whom I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. That was 1 Corinthians 11, 32. Now, I'm going to go Ephesians 5, 20. I'm trying to do it in chronological order. Ephesians 5, 20. Can't get it, man. I'm telling you, I'll be glad when it cools down a little bit. These papers are turning into mush. 5, 20, 20, 20. giving thanks always for all things unto the God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ raised from the dead on the third day, God raised him far above all principality, power, and might. Every name that is named not only in this world, but the one to come. Submitting yourselves to one another in the fear of God. That's where somebody comes and says, Danny, I got a problem with your ministry. Front and center. What's your problem? I think the entire New Testament is garbage.
Well,
and yes, I have read it. Not very much. What I get is just from basic information that's out there, Google. How does one come to the terms that we don't need the New Testament? You don't, lest you've been altered. Somebody has done something to your brain to make you think that this Bible has fallacies in it. Who told you you were naked? Satan. Why? Eve wanted to be a god, didn't she? You mean she wanted to be a god, but she had no idea what being a god was about? Just like these people want to be Bible pastors, but don't have a clue with what's inside of their Bible? Yep. This is why it's so important for you to know what's inside of your Bible, because they don't. And the only way you're going to know that they don't is if you know the truth. Because once you know the truth, you'll never lose it. All right, that was Ephesians 5. Let's go Second Timothy 3:2. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. All of that goes back to Romans 1. Romans 1. 22 through 32, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. That's who my neighbor was, a Jehovah's Witness. I knew that I didn't know a lot about God's word, but I knew enough about God's word that, what do I want to call it? Being immoral was wrong. You know, that's where they said, if you don't know how to act, you can watch the animals. The animals will teach you how to act. So when we see men with men, women with women, so that's where I knocked on my neighbor's door who was a Jehovah's Witness and asked him to show me in the Bible where it said being a homosexual was wrong. And I'm like looking back now, like all the places in the Bible, you know, God hates these five things. For this man to come to the door and actually have it in the but now dispensation, not just being a homosexual is wrong, but being carnal-minded is what the problem is. Carnal-minded, you're not seeking those things above, you're seeking right now. So if you're not tall enough, fast enough, maybe you don't got a good jump shot, don't worry, you're going to get a good glorified body. You didn't know, maybe the glorified body might not never dribble a basketball ever again. You didn't think about that, did you? Where we're going, we don't need roads. This is beyond our comprehension. You bouncing a little basketball around, that's just for fun. That's just for fun. That's like somebody says, what's heaven for a fisherman without fish? It's not your heaven. It's God's heaven. You're welcome to be a part of it. You're welcome to come. But don't start saying what God should have there and what God shouldn't have there. Because when you get there, you're not going to ever take your eyes off of them. Ever see your dog staring at you? Hey, man. I got this book that says Whistle for Willie. I was saving it for you, bro. I seen it and I was like, Willie! Whistle for Willie! Willie! What's up, Willie? Hey, Willie! Who else gives you that welcome? Who else gives you that welcome when you come to their lives? Nobody. Nobody. Whistle for Willie! I seen the book over there the other day and I was like, Willie! I gotta get the book for Willie! I wonder, Willie, you ever read this book? I mean, I never read it. It's still brand new. All right, guys, we're going to go 1 Timothy chapter 2, okay? We love you, Willie. I'll be right back. So we'll read the chapter, 1 Timothy chapter 2. We'll read it. We'll come back and do the same thing that we do every other time and walk our way down through that. Only 15 verses, so we get on our horse, guys. We got 30 minutes. Plenty of time, man. Plenty of time. Paul said, I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications and prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. For all men. For kings and for all that in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time, whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle. I speak the truth in Christ and lie not. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity, I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. In like manner also that the women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broided hair or golds or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Let the women learn in silence with all subjection, but I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. For Adam was first formed, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in transgression. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing, if they continue in faith, charity, and holiness with sobriety. I thought the women were saved by believing in the gospel. By which you are saved. Paul's not talking to the women, is he? Brethren, that's everybody that believes. You are the brethren. 120 brethren in here. That's who Satan is, the accuser of the brethren. You're the accuser of the brethren. Remember that lady was tripping out in there? Somebody tried to help her. You could tell somebody tried to help her. God bless that person for trying to help, but at the same time, you're like, man, you might have just made things worse. Did you say you just don't agree with his religious views, or they don't align with yours, or what? She said, I'm just mad he won't repent. He's going to burn in hell, and so are you. I said, whoa! Y'all are having a revival over there, Neil? All right, let's go back to verse 1. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplication, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Go down to the last verse. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue in faith and charity with holiness and sobriety. All men, verse 1. Childbearing, verse 15. Can you bear a child? Then that's not talking about you, is it? Now, I know Google says women can have children, men can have children, but we don't go with what Google says, okay? We don't go with what Google says. Try the next verse. This is a true saying. If a man desire a bishop, he desire a good work. A good work. All right. I don't know. Wish us luck, guys. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. That's where I've said I think Paul prays a lot. for us throughout the 13 epistles. For example, First Ephesians chapter 1, what is it, 16 through 21? For the eyes of your understanding to be opened or to be enlightened, for you to understand what is the hope, the length, the width, the depth of his calling. All right, so for verse 1, let's go do 1 Timothy chapter 2, go down to verse 4. Who will have all men to be saved? God's will for all men to be saved. This is how we end up with universalists. They say God's will is going to happen. Okay? If God says all men are going to be saved, then all men are going to be saved. No, it's God's will for all men to be saved, meaning he provided the way for all men to be saved, because you have free choice, and that takes away from total depravity. But you have free will to come to the knowledge of the truth that you can exhort. What are you exhorting? The word of God. So we're exhorting, therefore, that first of all, supplications, intercessions be made. That's where Paul said, pray for me that I may open my mouth boldly, or pray for a door of utterance, that I can get the opportunity to talk about God to somebody. So let's go look at Romans chapter 6, verse 17. Romans 6, 17. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. What was delivered? Paul said, first of all, which I received, I also delivered. Back in Acts 9, Jesus Christ came from heaven and revealed 2/3 of the New Testament to the Apostle Paul. All right. Let's do 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 12. Wake up. Maybe I should put on a little makeup. You wanted to. Yeah. 1 Thess 3. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love toward one another and toward all men, even as we do towards you. So let me tell you a secret. As you continue, 1 Thessalonians 3:20. No. 3:12. 1 Thessalonians 3:12. I'm sorry. Increase, abound in love. As you grow in the knowledge of the Lord and you come to terms with how much God loves us, that love is a consuming fire. Your love is going to start abounding. People will be able to see Christ in you. Danny, what'd you do help that person for? I would never have done that. Right? You mean I can just go up to the 7-Eleven and swipe my card until somebody comes in and pays for my stuff? Most people do it because they want to keep score. They want somebody else to see that they did something good. How about it's just better to give than it is to receive? How about I'll never see that guy ever again? You think he'll remember me? No. You do things for people because sometimes you see they just need it and you can help them. Nice to be needed. So 1 Thessalonians 3:12. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love toward another, toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end that he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. Saints. Over there you're talking about saints. Saints. Are they angels? Who's the saints? Believers. All right, I'm just making sure. I'm just making sure, man, you know, somebody will say that they went to heaven and turned into an angel, just like they woke up one day and turned into a prophet. No. He said, hail to the no, hail to the no. Proverbs 24:21, did you write that down? I got Jeremiah 29:7. Please write that down as well. 1 Thessalonians 3:12. We just read that. Romans 6:17. I got Philippians 1:3. We didn't read that. Philippians 1:3. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, making requests with joy. 55,000 denominations are praying also. What are they praying for? Me, myself, and I, solo ride until I die, right? Money, hoes, and clothes, that's all a brother knows. Carnal-minded people are going to do carnal-minded things. Why? Because God hasn't gave the increase to them yet. That was Philippians 1:3. I've got Titus chapter 2, verse 11. Write that down. 2 Timothy 2:24. Write that down. Hey, Willie, come on back, man. Ephesians 5:20. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Verse 2. Okay. Verse 2. 1 Timothy 2. For kings and for all that in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. Quiet, peaceful life. Proverbs 24:1. 24:1. Too legit, quit. Right? Too legit, quit. Right. Very good. Let's do all right, I got Romans 12:18. I didn't stay there. Romans 12:18. They're like, no, Danny, you go, we'll wait here. We're safe. Romans 12:18. Khaled. DJ Khaled. Another one. We the best. No, you ain't. Sorry. That was Romans 12:18. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. That's verse 19 as well. All right, so we're going to go to Romans 13 now. Romans 13, verses 1 through 7. Let every soul be subject unto higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good work, but to evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger, to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore, ye must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For this the cause, pay ye tribute also, for they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Always know who you're dealing with, guys. If you're dealing with a snake, treat him like a snake. Don't treat a snake like a teddy bear. He's going to bite you. Okay, remember, he's going to huff and puff, Pawpaw. I know what he's going to do, little girl, but you don't. He's not going to eat those three little pigs, Pawpaw. Yes, he is. She's like, no. He just wants to come in. And that's where you got a little kid, like the grandbaby, that's so innocent that they don't think that anybody would ever want to do anything harmful to somebody. What's going to happen if they don't let him in? He's going to huff. And he's going to puff. And then he's going to blow the house down. I said, well, they better put up some bracing, right? Better push the couch up against the door. You better do whatever you can to block that dude from coming in. And that's what we're doing with Satan. We're putting all the Bible verses in between us and Satan that we can. Even if Satan attacks me, the righteousness of Jesus Christ is what justifies us. So without studying your Bible, you won't know the answers. So when you go get attacked, you don't have the answers. That's where they lie and wait to deceive. Now, this is what you should be doing. I need you to get up in front of the congregation right in the middle of the pastor's sermon and start shundalalaing real loud out there and cause more confusion than there already is inside of this building. Okay. I got Titus chapter 2, verses 10 through 14. Just write that down. Titus chapter 2, 10 through 14. We'll go on down into verse 3. Verse 3, it seems like we got about 10 minutes, guys. So we'll call this the last verse. And then we'll pick up in verse 4 for tomorrow, okay? For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior. In the sight of God, our Savior, right? Colossians 1:10. Colossians chapter 1, verse 10. That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Are you increasing in the knowledge of God? If not, maybe you're sitting under bad teaching. I can't really tell you what you're sitting under. I'm not there. I can tell you that you're way better off to stay home and study out God's word than you are about going and seeing somebody else. Man. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9. Who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus when? Before the world began. Before the world began and after the world began, are they different times? Before and after. Let's just narrow it down a little bit. Are they different times? Remember? Words that are spelled different are different. One's before and one's after. One's previously and one's later. I guess you can break it down however you want. All right, so that's 2 Timothy 1:9. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. What do you mean by the commandment of God our Savior? Acts 26:18, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light. There you go. Backwards man. Let's do Philippians chapter 1, verse 1. Hold your place. Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus which are at Philippi, and with the bishops and deacons. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Hold on. Philippians 1:11, go down to verse 11. Being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. But I would that you should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. So that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all of the palace and in other places. Some people had only heard of Paul's conversion. They hadn't seen him yet. So let's do Philippians 4:18. But I have all and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of a sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well-pleasing to God. But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 12, 1 through 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. The measure of faith. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Verse 1. Furthermore then, we beseech you, brother, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as you have received of us how you ought to walk and to please God, so you would abound more and more. For you know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from all fornication. That every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the lust of conspicuance, even as the Gentiles which know not God. What that does is picks us up right back in verse 4. Anybody know a good number 4? I don't know any good number 4s.
See, what do you mean, Daddy? You got number 4 right there on your corner at your coordinate.
He's not a good number 4. Do you know a good number 4? We could always say Earnhardt plus 1. No, that don't count. Number 4. Number 1, meet number 2.
Ooh, very good, John.
That's what we're saying. Who does number 2 work for? Number 4. Brett Favre. We'll pick up Brett Favre. I think he's getting sued or something.
Is he? What are you doing watching Satan's agenda for, KJ? Huh? You over there supporting Satan's jockstrap is what you're doing, bro.
I can't lie. I got caught up watching the volleyball yesterday. It was like a whole bunch of volleyballers, and then there was only 2 volleyballers, and I was like, there's some serious volleyballing going on out here.
It's okay. Don't let it consume you.
How do you know when you've been consumed? You might be on the team. That's a dead giveaway, isn't it? Out there holding up demonic signals, hoping that don't nobody know, right?
I know, brother. I love basketball, too.
I'm just giving you a hard time. I love you guys.
Remember, guys, right here, Brett Favre tomorrow morning, 5 o'clock. I'm off this evening. It's on Cat, okay? 7 o'clock, Cat's going to be here. If you don't follow Cat, you're missing out. Follow our sister Cat. If you can't find Cat, tell me or tell somebody else, and we'll put you over to the right place, okay? 7 o'clock this evening, guys. Cat's going to take us to the, what did it say? Take it to the house. Take it to the house. Take it to the house. 3 on 5. Take it to the house. Yo, I got that 5. Take it to the house, right? Slip and slide. Take it to the house. Take it to the house. Take it to the house. See you guys in the morning. Y'all take care.